We are back. Goldenbach University, 102. Well, 103, 108. How are you, ladies and gentlemen? I'm Ralph Tycho with the Comfortably Zoned Radio Network. The Professor Peter Goldenbach has not joined us this evening as of yet, but Alan Blumkin, my co-host on this show and on others, and Robin Deniger, first time on this show, and a Yankee, New York Yankee podcaster on this very station, joins us on the Goldenbach Show. Without the hero, without the professor, we're going to have to sit in, maybe student teach each other. Robert, welcome.
Thank you.
That was a convoluted introduction. Mr. Blumkin, how goes it, sir? Your Pirates won 2 out of 3 against...
Now I can go back to rooting for the Yankees. I hope they beat the hell out of the Red Sox the next 3 games.
Oh, okay, good, good. So you have you'll root for the Yankees unless they're playing the Pirates. And since 1960, haven't been many regular season games or games Pirates against the Yankees. While we're at it, 1960, you became a Pirate fan when you went off to the University of Pittsburgh.
Before that, I won a couple of bucks by a friend of mine that they would finish ahead of the Giants in 1958.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
And then I started being able to pick their games up on WWVA Wheeling, West Virginia, which was 1170 on the dial, because KVKA, which is 1020, was the primary station for them, was trapped between WYNS and whatever, 1050 was being called at that particular time. That's
okay.
The only time I've ever played against the Yankees in anything was when 1960, and when they played the Pirates. That's it.
Okay, that Robert, I'm sure you have very few recollections of the 1960 World Series.
Yeah, none.
None. How old were you?
Yeah.
Out of curiosity.
I was born in 1976.
All right, that puts it all into perspective. I envy you your youth, my friend, as you do envy me. My memories.
Yes, I do.
All right, so we have a good relationship there. 1960 to you, Al. You started liking, you bet against them, bet for them in 58 against the Giants. You really didn't like the Giants, let's face it.
No, I wasn't. I mean, the team I disliked most when I was a kid growing up in the 50s was the Brooklyn Dodgers.
Right.
As I mentioned, when I moved to Queens in 1951, every kid my age was either from Brooklyn or the Bronx. I was from the Bronx. So I argued things like Joe Collins was better than Gil Hodges, even though I knew that was crazy. And in 1955, I ran home and I started crying and pounding the sofa when I watched the last inning of that series. I couldn't believe
the Tommy Byrne World Series at the end.
Yeah.
Everybody should have been Tommy Byrne. It was Johnny Padres.
And they got back. They got back the next year, and they did the same thing to the Braves in '58 after losing to them in '57. I started following them during the time that they won the 5 straight. And I remember in March 1954 when I was the ripe old age of 10 and I heard on the radio that the Yankees sold Vic Rashi to the Cardinals. I was up all night crying. I think I'm thinking
really?
They would make it to school the next day after that one.
Yeah, that was right before my cognizant time as a baseball player.
Yeah, and my all-time favorite player ever is Yogi.
Right. Baseball misses the combination of Yogi Berra and Joe Garagiola, not comparing them as players, naturally, but as icons, a broadcasting icon, and the not-so-glib Yogi Berra. How many of those statements that Yogi was reputedly made, how many of them were embellished or enhanced, changed by Joe Garagiola?
He published 3 books worth of them. So he, right. I mean, he did what he should have done. He turned the whole thing into a very big money-making proposition.
Right. Yogi himself, speaking of money, he had the golden touch, whereas many of his Yankee teammates ran into financial problems. Mantle, Ford, a lot of them just didn't do well. Yogi did well on everything he touched. Plus, he was fortunate enough to take an active ownership. His endorsement changed for money or for stock in the company on a chocolate drink called Yoo-hoo. Or was it Yoo-hoo?
Yoo-hoo, yeah.
Oh, okay. That funny name, you may say, but his endorsement and pictures of him and his other Yankee teammates in Yoo-hoo T-shirts when they posed for when they had interviews, post-game interviews, made that stock rise, and Yoo-hoo would make Yogi an awful lot of money over and above the money he made as a player. And what seemed to be guaranteed to him every year was World Series checks.
Oh, yeah.
He cashed in on more of those than any player ever, if I'm not mistaken.
As a player, 14 pennants and 10 World Series.
Yeah, well.
Nobody ever approached that.
No player. I think the combination of playing and coaching with the Yankees, Crosetti might have been right up there in World Series rings.
Yeah, he was up there.
Yogi
got, as a coach a couple of times, he got 2 with the Mets. 69, 73, a pennant winning, World Series and a pennant winner. And he got rings in, as a Yankee manager in 64, he lost, but he got rings in 77 and 78.
Right. How did the Steinbrenner feud escalate? Was it just mainly his firing?
After 16 games into the 1985 season. And he found out, Steinbrenner didn't tell him directly, sent one of his flunkies to tell Berra that he was out. And Berra thought he was treated shabbily and vowed never to go back to Yankee Stadium. And what happened is 1999, after Joe DiMaggio passed, Yogi became the leading Yankee icon. And Susan Waldman, who does the Yankee announcing, brokered it, and Steinbrenner went out to the museum in Montclair, New Jersey, basically almost got on his hands and knees begging Yogi to come back. So Yogi finally agreed to end his 14-year exile. He came back. I was there for Yogi Berra Day, and they gave him a whole bunch of things, and that was the day David Cohn pitched his perfect game, and they brought in Don Larson. To make a throw to Yogi Berra to open the game. Larson, of course, had pitched the game, the perfect game of the 56 series. And they both stayed there and watched Cohn pitch his perfect game, which was one of the most incredible things of all time.
Oh, yeah. And the most incredible thing of all time in relationship to that was what you mentioned when Larson pitched the perfect game in the 56 World Series. And, it was back in the days, and nobody remembers this because Things have changed, but the World Series was actually played in the daytime. So kids like me, age 10, could run home from school and watch the last few innings, as I did October 6th, 1956. I watched it on TV with my mother, who turns out from a conversation we had that day while watching the end of the game, she wasn't much of a baseball fan, but her father, my grandfather, was a fanatic and took me to early games when I was a kid and taught it all to me. I didn't realize, though, that my mother had been to the 1939 game when Lou Gehrig stood up and said that he was the luckiest man in the world. So we watched the last three innings of that thing together, and we talked about her going to the game in 1939. Somebody had laid some nuggets on my grandfather up in Mount Kisco, and he couldn't go, gave it to his daughter, and she took a friend, and she got to witness Yankee history. And I remember having goosebumps. I said, "You were at that game?" You know, even at 10, that's, you know, there was the movie, Pride of the Yankees. Tell me what you thought of that movie, Alan.
I'm not a big fan of baseball bios as movies.
Okay.
Gary Cooper was, you know, they had to reverse everything because Gary Cooper was right-handed. And I guess for its
time,
it was pretty good. But I just think they try to make, I mean, Babe Ruth has the all-time record for bad movies made about a ballpointer. And if you sit through that William Bendix Babe Ruth story without your jaw dropping, that's an accomplishment. But
yeah,
you know, Pride of the Yankees, I guess for its time, it was good. But I'm not a big fan of these attempted baseball bios. The only one I thought was any good was the 42. The reason why about Jackie Robinson.
Jackie.
61 asterisk wasn't too bad. But aside of the guys who played Mantle and Maris, the minor characters were not very well thought out.
I thought they captured Seaburn pretty, not Seaburn, Serve,
yeah,
pretty well. And the detail in 61 asterisk was incredible. The helmets that they used, the texture, the top of the helmets, the uniforms, they really captured it. And who could have done a better job casting? Those two people looked and acted so much like Maris.
Yeah.
You know? It was a little corny. What got me, though, was the last part when the Maris family was visiting McGuire and all of that. It was just a sign of a movie of the times, but I thought it was tremendously authenticative from a standpoint of capturing the ambiance of the stadium. I think it was filmed after the first stadium had, the original Yankee Stadium was replaced.
I think they used the Tiger Stadium.
I think he's Tiger Stadium, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, the movie also showed very well Mickey's personality, you know, what he was going
through. There's a voice. Wait a minute, the teacher has arrived. Put that. Stop chewing gum, everybody. Peter Golenbach, welcome.
Thank you.
Okay. Glad you can make it. Tell me your thoughts of that movie, Peter. And I'd meet Robert Denninger. He is the New York Yankee podcast show on this network. He's the co-host of that, and I'd like you to meet Peter Golenbach. Peter Golenbach, Robert Denninger.
Peter, it's a pleasure.
Very, very good. Very wonderful.
Peter, the movie itself.
Yeah, well, the movie itself really described very well the relationship between Mickey and Roger. Both of them, in their own way, you know, had to go through a lot. I mean, every single day since about July 4th, somebody was asking Roger Maris, do you think you can beat Babe Ruth's record? And Roger, who was a very, very sort of a private guy, didn't particularly like the media. He was a he played in Kansas City where he was very happy because the media left him alone, the fans left him alone. And he just, the pressure in New York certainly is so much greater than the pressure just about anywhere else in baseball, except perhaps Boston. So Roger found himself in the middle of something he really didn't want to be in the middle of, even though he was having such a magnificent, magnificent year. And it was hard on him. And by the last couple of weeks, he had so much pressure on him that his hair was falling out, literally in clumps. And he would have crying jags. I mean, it was very tough. And Mickey, of course, Mickey had his own problems. Mickey was something of an alcoholic. And Mickey, I don't know, Mickey just had a hard time being Mickey. And it was interesting. These two rather emotionally frail people were going through perhaps the greatest baseball season, unless you want to count McGuire and Sosa in 1998. But these two guys are going through, you know, for most of us, the greatest baseball season we had ever seen. And the movie showed that, what was going on behind the scene. I thought that was pretty terrific.
Good. Anything that you'd have, you have against the movie, or in other words, are there any downsides to the movie that was terribly?
I don't know. I've got to be careful about the downsides. I went to the premiere of The Natural in New York.
Right.
Bernard Malamud had written this fabulous book called The Natural. And at the end of his book, his hero basically does what the Black Sox did, which is to take money to throw games, and they get caught. And in the book, the hero, you know, is walking out of a courtroom, and some kid is, you know, saying, you know, the old say it ain't so, Joe, that they said to Joe Jackson at the end of the Black Sox. So anyhow, so I go to this movie, knowing full well what the book was about. And, of course, Robert Redford was stunning. I mean, he was just fabulous. What a great athlete he is. And at the end of the movie, instead of throwing a game, of course, the owner wanted him to throw a game. And instead of doing so, he went up against the wishes of the owner and hits a home run to win the pennant, and that breaks the light in right field, and it smashes into a million pieces, and he runs around the bases, and he's the greatest hero who ever could be. So this is the first time I saw the movie, and I was pissed because it wasn't what the book was. And so me and my big mouth, I say to my friend, I said, this movie really sucks. And so, of course, sitting in front of me was the sister of the director. And she turns around, you know, he turns around to me and says, you know, you really ought to keep your criticism to yourself. And I apologized to her, and I felt like a schmuck for the next 20 years. At any rate, the second time I saw The Natural, I thought, you know, this really is quite a very good movie. And by the 15th time that I saw The Natural, I came to believe it was one of the two or three finest baseball movies that they ever made. My career as a critic, not so good.
I resisted Field of Dreams because Ray Liotta, who was playing Shoeless Joe Jackson, was batting from the wrong side and throwing from the wrong side.
I can understand that. I cannot see. I don't consider Field of Dreams one of the very best. Beside The Natural, the other film baseball film that I'm just crazy about is League of Their Own.
Every time I see that movie with
Tom Hanks playing Jimmy Fox, I just get goosebumps and I start crying. I mean, it's just one magnificent movie, that movie.
Yeah.
And I think 42 is probably the third one in the triumvirate of truly great movies.
You know, there was Mark Harris wrote a trilogy.
He did.
Bang the
Drum. He did.
Slowly.
Yes.
And
the Southpaw and Ticket to Steamsich. Those were the three.
Oh, I love those three books. They were published in a paperback edition that I still have, tattered as it is, all three novels. And that book was Sal Magley. I always thought of the author. He was from Buffalo or upstate New York. And that was terrific. I don't think the movie did the book justice at all. And that one, De Niro.
And yet the movie had wonderful actors. De Niro played
De Niro,
Patrick.
Yes. Yeah.
And that fabulous actor from the Law and Order show, he played the pitcher.
Michael
Moriarty.
Oh, yeah.
He played the pitcher. And, you know, the there was some very affecting work there. I mean, Moriarty knew that De Niro was dying of cancer and did everything he possibly could to keep him on the team, even though De Niro was not playing very well. I thought that was rather touching, actually, for
absolutely. But, again, most movies don't do the books justice.
And most moviegoers don't read the books, so they have no idea. Nobody in that movie theater when I went to see The Natural, I don't think, ever read Malamud's book, The Natural. So they didn't have the same feeling about it.
Any of you ever see Safe at Home?
Safe at Home. Is that the Billy Crystal one?
No, Safe at Home was Billy Crystal was 61 Oscars. This was a movie made after the 61 season. Starring Mickey Mantle and Roger Maris.
I have the movie poster sitting right behind me.
William Frawley.
I have the movie poster sitting right behind me. William Frawley.
He drags to a school that he can get Mantle and Maris to come to the school. And,
right.
The greatest thing I ever heard was Whitey Ford was in that movie. He had one line. He says, "Ralph wants to see you guys." And Whitey Ford got paid $300 for saying that line. And he was absolutely thrilled.
Yeah, that's right. Right.
It's a lot of
fun
money
and
in those
laughter.
Days.
Fun and laughter with the idols of millions and the luckiest kid in the world. Mickey Mantle, Roger Maris, Safe at Home with William Frawley, Patricia Barry, and Don Collier.
Yeah.
Yeah. I never saw the movie.
William Frawley made that movie. He was such a good manager. That was so well done. They were charming in that movie. Mert and I went to see that at the Boulevard Theater in the winter of 61.
Compared to the Hollywood movies of William Bendix, The Babe Ruth Story, and Anthony Perkins, and Fear Strikes Out, Safe at Home was a masterpiece.
Well, I'll tell you what should be right up there. And then I'm going to ask you all the same question, and it doesn't – let me just tell you, it's Major League about the Cleveland
Indians. Oh, I love that movie.
Yeah.
I love the movie. I love Major League 2. I love both those movies.
I don't remember Major League 2. It didn't get as good reviews, but that was a terrific movie. It had a love interest.
It was.
Had it
Bob
all.
Bob Uecker was great in that.
Bob Uecker is a little bit outside. And there was one other movie we are forgetting about. We are forgetting about Susan Sarandon.
Oh, yes.
Playing Annie. What was Annie's last name? She was
Annie
the
baseball.
Love interest. Yeah. She was the
baseball
love interest.
Baseball Annie.
Yeah. What was the name of that movie? Fabulous, fabulous movie.
It was
with Kevin Costner was the pitcher.
Bull Durham.
That was Bull Durham. That's it. That's it. The fellow who wrote Bull Durham used to be a minor league baseball player. The guy who wrote it and made it.
Oh.
And the man, okay. The man is pretty close to being a genius. I mean, his dialogue in that Bull Durham movie was absolutely stunning. You know, when the players would come out to the mound and they'd have a conference, and the pitcher would say to the infielders, you know, my friend is getting married. You know, what sort of gift should I give my friend for his wedding gift? And they're standing out in the mound in the middle of the game talking about this.
Yeah.
And I have to suspect,
the first baseman thought he had a hex on his glove.
Yeah. No, it was just terrific.
Were you ever asked to write a screenplay on any of your books or?
Jim Bouton at one point, got himself hired to do a series of TV shows based on Ball 4. So six shows that he was doing. That we're going to show, you know, the fun and games of baseball behind the scene. And we both lived in Englewood, New Jersey at the time, and we were very, very close friends. And he invited me over, and he said, you know, we're working on this show. Why don't you be involved? And I thought to myself, well, that sounds like fun. So I don't know if you remember the Seinfeld episode where George and Jerry – for the very first time, are sitting down to write the pilot for the Seinfeld show that they were writing. So
it's all about nothing.
Jerry writes down hello, and an hour later, George says to Jerry, what do we have so far? And Jerry says, hello. Well, that was me. I mean, to write dialogue that is snappy and funny and – I mean, you really have to be a special, special kind of a person. And I was not that kind of a person. I give, you know, Jerry Seinfeld and Larry David, you know, such genius for 25 years they've been doing shows like that.
I'm guessing, Peter, that you recognize the genius of Curb Your Enthusiasm.
Oh, heavens, yes. Heavens.
Good.
Yes. Oh,
I'm in. I could sit and watch outtakes and bloopers of them on YouTube for hours. I could listen to Susie screaming obscenities.
Absolutely.
Because we've all been screamed at.
when the brownies come to Larry David's house and want to sell him cookies, and Larry just gives these little girls all sorts of grief. I mean, and the parents of the Girl Scouts come over. It's like, what's wrong with you?
Right. And he's talking to the cops. He says, I think it's a hate crime against bald people. And the black
guy
has his head shaved. And he says, well, sir, I'm bald and I'm not offended. He says, you're not bald. Your baldness is a fashion statement. I'm bald. It's just unbelievably great.
Well,
Seinfeld.
It's 20 years of it. You still can just say, you just say certain things. Like, it's a Titleist. Where George goes
the
into
whale.
The whale. He goes
the
into
whale.
The whale to save the whale by pulling a golf ball out of his blowhole after Kramer is standing on the shore hitting golf balls into the water.
that is beautiful. There were two. One where Elaine is talking to the woman at a party and she says, where's my fiancé? Has anybody seen my baby? Has anybody seen my darling? And she goes, the dingo ate your baby.
The dingo ate your baby. Yes. Yes. Or all of the Steinbrenner episodes. All the Steinbrenner episodes where they have to bring Steinbrenner a calzone. And it's raining that day. So Kramer is supposed to bring the calzone, but something happens to him. And then the mailman, Newman, is supposed to bring Steinbrenner the calzone. But Newman can't bring the calzone because it's raining, which is hilarious because he's a postman. And even rain or sleet or da-da-da-da-da, the postman always does what he does. But he's not bringing Steinbrenner's calzone because it's raining. And the funny thing about that, is that somebody in the Yankee organization had to be feeding Larry David information, because George Steinbrenner every day ate the same thing for lunch. He had the same thing every single day for lunch. Not only that, but there was an employee who always arrived in the Yankee offices before everybody else, okay? So they decided then on the Seinfeld show that they were going – George got this carpenter to build a bed under the desk so that he could always be the first person to arrive at, you know, in the office in the morning. So these incredibly hilarious moments were actually based on something that was really true. People don't realize it because they – didn't know what was going on inside the Yankees. And I was writing a book on Steinbrenner at the time, so I had some sources. And they were telling me about some of the things that were then picked up by the Seinfeld show, which is just truly hilarious.
I just want to, because I know time is getting short, I want to turn it over to Robert Denninger.
Good.
And I want him to ask you some – as a Robert's younger than us. We established that before you got on, Peter. I want
younger
Robert
than
to
us. Robert is younger than us.
I couldn't imagine that.
Really? I don't know.
I'm going to be 73.
Well, he wants to. He's been thinking of things that if he could only speak to Peter Golenbach. Imagine how I felt a year and a half ago when all this started. Robert, what would you like to ask Mr. Golenbach?
Well, earlier you brought up the 1960 World Series, and I know the Yankees played the Pirates, and I know the Pirates beat them in seven games. I forget.
We refused. By the way, we refused to accept that.
Yes.
We refused to accept that. We want a do-over.
But
well,
if
you get Hal Smith to come back, and you'd have to get right Hal Smith.
Yeah, that's right.
Right. There were two. One was a Cardinal catcher, and I think one of them came from the Yankees originally.
Yeah, Alan. He was sent to Baltimore when they got lost in the Turley. He never played for the Yankees.
There were 15 catchers. 15 catchers. Who ended up in the major leagues after leaving the Yankees because nobody played behind Yogi Berra. Yogi Berra played from 1946 to 19. He even played in 64. He played all that time. And the only person
he even played in 65 with the Mets.
Yeah, he played a couple games with the Mets too. But my point was that there were so many fine Yankee catchers. The Washington catcher was Clint Courtney. He was from the Yankees. Hal Smith was from the Yankees. There are all sorts of
Lawler.
Sherm Lawler was from the Yankees. All these people.
Gus Triandos
once was a Yankee. And they ended up in the major leagues with other teams because Yogi Berra was the greatest, you know, catcher of them all. And there was just no room for everybody. Anybody. Okay, so what did you want to ask me about the 60 series?
The Yankees, I think, outscored Pittsburgh something like 55 to 17 runs in the series, I think.
Well, we won games 14 to 2. Won games 12 to 2. We won one game 10 to nothing. So there was no way. There was absolutely no way. Let's see, I was 14 years old. No way as a 14-year-old that I could ever conceive of the Yankees losing to the crummy Pittsburgh Pirates, for crying out loud. I mean, who were their stars? You know, Dick Groat? I mean, yes, they had Clemente. We appreciated Clemente. But at the time, Clemente was from Puerto Rico. And so in America, Puerto Ricans really didn't count.
Yeah.
You know? I mean, he never – Clemente, who was truly one of the greatest ball players who ever was, because he was, a Latino, never ever got the credit for it. So, nobody ever thought that he was going to be much of a decision maker, and nobody had much respect for the Pirates pitchers. You know, cripes, we had Whitey Ford. Only one thing that Casey Stengel did in all those years where he really goofed, and that was not starting Whitey Ford. He got fired because he was old. But what happened was Casey did not start Whitey Ford in the first game of the 1960 World Series. If he had started him in the first game, he could have pitched the first game, the fourth game, and the seventh game. And there's no way in hell, if that had happened, that the Pirates ever would have come close to winning the World Series. But Casey had this thing for Art Dittmar, who had a very nice year in 1960, and he decided that Dittmar should be the first pitcher in the World Series, and that kept Whitey from pitching three games, and that's really why.
Ford had a sore arm a good part of that season and wound up 12-9. I think that was part of the reason that Casey was reluctant to use him.
Well, he was okay. Whitey was okay at the end. I don't know. Casey just, he made a mistake. And quite frankly, the Yankees never should have lost that last game. There was a ball that hit the ground and then
Oaks,
a terrible
Oaks,
bounce
Oaks,
and hit Kubek in the throat. I almost killed him.
I spoke to Johnny Blanchard at the card show in 1987 and about that game, and because he was catching,
he blamed
the whole damn thing on Colts, not covering first base, and then throwing a fastball to Hal Smith when everybody in the whole world knew that the only pitch that Smith could hit was fastballs.
Well, understand, everybody hated Jim Coates anyway.
Yeah, well, Blanchard, this is 27 years later.
He
went out to the mound. And says, Coach was shaking him off all the breaking pitches he was asking for, and Coach threw the fastball and Smith deposited over the wall.
I think there was a reason that Ellie Howard wasn't catching.
He was hurt.
Or Yogi Berra wasn't catching.
Yogi was in left field, and Ellie Howard was hurt. Ellie Howard did not play.
Yes, Ellie Howard was hurt. That's the other reason the Yankees lost the pennant in 1960, that Ellie Howard was hurt. As Clemente was treated with the Pirates, people did not realize that Ellie Howard was a year after year after year after year all-star catcher. I think Ellie Howard was an all-star catcher 9 times, which is astounding because he didn't start. Yogi started.
Right.
And it was only after Ralph Houk replaced Stengel in 1961 that Elston Howard got the opportunity to catch. And Yogi was given a secondary sort of a position. And as a result, Ellie Howard ends up hitting, 361 and winning a most valuable player. Ellie Howard, if he had been with any other team with the Yankees, would be in the Hall of Fame right now. And I would argue that he belongs in the Hall of Fame right now anyway.
I would, too. Him not getting the Yankee job as manager just broke
his heart. Well, there is a new book coming out. And I know this because I read it and I wrote a blurb for it. Ellie Howard's wife, Arlene, has written a new book called Ellie and Me. And he wrote it with Ralph Wimbush. Now, Ralph Wimbush is the son of the gentleman who lives in St. Petersburg here. And he was the one when the black players during spring training needed a place to stay. They could not stay at the Sereno Hotel. So they stayed with Ralph Wimbush's father. So Arlene had a connection to Ralph, who is a newspaper reporter who lives in New York City. And they wrote this really, really wonderful book. And it's really bittersweet because nobody ever realized that every time that George Steinbrenner fired Billy Martin, Ellie Howard would call Steinbrenner up and say, you need to hire me. There's never been an African-American manager, and I should be the first African-American manager. And Steinbrenner never did it. And when Ellie was traded to the Boston Red Sox, at the time Dick Williams was fired, Ellie went to the Boston Red Sox front office and said, you should hire me as the manager. Now, Ellie was this fabulous catcher who all the pitchers relied on. They all knew what a fabulous, fabulous baseball mind Ellie had. The problem was, in the 1960s and 1970s, that racism was still just virulent in the United States. And so, you know, for years and years and years, until Frank Robinson was hired by Cleveland, no black had an opportunity to manage. And so Ellie Howard went to his death. I mean, very, very interesting that Jackie Robinson died at age 53 because of all the indignities and all the pain that he suffered as the first. Ellie Howard died at age 51 for much of the same reason.
If he asked the Red Sox for the managerial job, the Red Sox were the most racist organization.
Like he's going to get that job from York.
Well, that's absolutely right. That's exactly right. But it can't hurt to ask.
No, it can't. But it also increases the indignities that the man had to endure by having to ask.
No question about it.
He was really responsible. Ellie going over there handling that pitching staff in Boston in 67. They would not have won in 67.
That's exactly right.
The fact that Ellie wasn't asked is an indignity. And nobody else
asked him either. I mean, there were how many other clubs? You know, there were a bunch of other clubs. None of those clubs ever asked him either. He was never in consideration to be a manager. And he ended up with an enlarged heart. He was terribly sick the last couple of years of his life, and there was his wife, you know, one of the last lines of the baseball book that his wife wrote was, baseball killed him.
Oh, man.
Whoa.
Yeah. I don't know.
We can't top that in terms of talking about anything else. Let's come back next week, gentlemen.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right, folks. Have a great week.
Enjoyed it.
Thank
you for joining us, Robert. Thank you, Alan Blumkin. Thank you, Professor. We'll be back next week.
Okay,
keep an eye on everybody. Good night.
All right.
Good night.